So far in this lecture series of DBMS, we have already discussed about normalization, all the normal forms, first, second, third and BCNF, all the rules and regulations of those normal forms and how to identify that a particular given relation is in desired normal form or not. But we haven't discussed how to convert a given relation into desired normal form. For example, if a relation is given and that is in third normal form and you want to convert it into BCNF, then how to convert that? We haven't discussed that process, but I'll discuss everything about normalization later one by one in the later videos. Right now in this video, I'm going to discuss about decomposition and properties of decomposition. See, for normalization, you have to do what? You have to decompose the table. You have to divide, in simple terms you can say you have to divide the relation, the table. Okay, suppose a given relation is in second normal form, to convert it into higher normal form you have to decompose this relation into sub relation. We have to divide this relation. Okay, but it's not like that. Like suppose a relation is given having a, b, c, d, four attributes, so just divide. R1 is having A and B and second sub-relation is R2 which is having C and D, and that's it. If you see that, yeah, obviously we have decomposed this R1 into two sub-relation R1 and R2. But you have to follow some properties. It's not like that you directly decompose it. We cannot do like this. The decomposition should, or you can say must, follow some properties. So first property is what? This dependency preserving property. And second is what? Lossless. Means the decomposition should be dependency preserving and lossless. In this video, I'll discuss about dependency preserving decomposition. In the next video, we'll discuss lossless decomposition. Okay, with help of an example, I'm going to discuss this thing. Fine. So now here, decomposition means, I guess you know, it's dividing the relation, okay, in two or three or four, means you can say multiple sub-relations. Here dependency means functional dependency. What is functional dependency? That also we have discussed in one of our previous video. You can check out that video. Now see, what is dependency preserving decomposition, right? I'll discuss this one with the help of this example. I'm taking this small example, a relation having A, B, C, three attributes. These are the values in this relation, right? Now, can you derive the functional dependency set of this relation? See, what is functional dependency? How to derive functional dependency set from a given relation? That also we have discussed in our previous video. You can check out that video in the I button. If you are directly watching this video, then I recommend you please check that video. If you know the concept, how to derive functional dependency, then it's fine. Here functional dependency may be, see here A can derive B and A can derive C. Definitely by looking at this table we can see this. How I'm going to drive this? See, I know I'm going to get many comments about this, ma'am, how did you write A drive B, A drive C? So that is why I am saying that please watch the previous video first of all. Okay, so if A drive B, A drive C, so using that Armstrong axiom, the union property, we can write A drive BC, right? And only B cannot drive anything, only C cannot drive anything, but both B and C combinedly can drive A. See here, why B cannot drive anything? Suppose I am taking B drive C. Is it functional dependency here? No. See, the value of B in these two rows is 1 and 1, same in two rows. It means the value of C must be same in these two rows, but it is different, so it is not a functional dependency, right? I hope you know the property of that functional dependency. Now suppose I have decomposed this relation into two sub relation one is having AB and R2 is having, suppose, PC. So the values would be, and in this sub relation values would be 1, 2 and 1, 2. Two sub-relations are there, right? Now, find out the functional dependency set for this sub-relation, right? Suppose I am taking this as F, right? F is containing these two and this functional dependency is F1. Now see, obviously either A can drive V, B can drive A. These two functional dependency can be possible. Yes, of course, A can drive A, B can drive B. This is trivial functional dependency. So we are not going to write trivial functional dependencies, right? That are by default present here. Or in any relation, trivial functional dependencies are present by default. So we no need to write these functional dependencies. See, here we can write A can drive B. Yeah, that is possible. Can B drive A? No. So only one functional dependency is possible in this relation. For this one, suppose I am taking set as F2. Can B drive C? No. Can C drive B? No. So this set is null. Means nothing is there in this set. So there is no functional dependency in this R2 relation. Okay. Now see, logically if you think, then what should be a case? This F1 union F2 means when you combine these set, this functional dependency set and this functional dependency set, right? Then this union must be equivalent to what? Obviously this functional dependency set, right? Because from this relation only we have divided, we have decomposed, we have derived these two sub-relation. So the functional dependency set, the union of functional dependency set of these sub-relation must be equivalent to this one, right? Now check, when you do F1 union F2, then you get only A derive B because this is null. But F is what? A derive BC, BC derive A. These are not equivalent, right? Suppose this one complete I am taking at G. Rather than writing this one F1 union F2, I am writing G. G is equal to this one. So the situation should be this F should be equivalent to G. Or you can say G must be equivalent to F. But here this is not a case. So this is what? Not a dependency preserving. Here the original dependency, the dependency set of the original relation are not being preserved after decomposition of this relation. So this is not a dependency preserving decomposition, right? So this should not be a case. When you normalize the relation, so you decompose that relation, but that decomposition should be dependency preserving. This union must be equal to the original one, right? Now suppose here I have divided into two relation only, but in general terms, what you can write? Suppose I have divided this relation R into R1, R2, R3 up to Rn, multiple relations. Yeah, that is quite possible. You can divide it into, you can decompose that relation into multiple relations, or you need to decompose that relation into multiple relation till you get your desired normal form. That also we will discuss, that how to decompose it, how to convert a relation into your desired normal form later with the help of proper example. Suppose I have divided into n relation. So the functional dependency set of this one is suppose F1. For this one, it is F2, it is F3 and Fn. The original one is, I am taking suppose for this F only, right? So now the rule should be what? This union, F1 union F2 union up to Fn must be equivalent to F. In general term, you can write down something like this. This is what? If this is a case, then you can say that it is dependency preserving, right? If this union is a proper subset of F, you can say a proper subset of F, then it is not dependency preserving. Now, how to check this and this are equivalent, right? This also we will discuss now with the help of a proper example, okay? So let us take one more example. So this is the relation having these attributes and these are the functional dependencies on this relation. Now suppose I have divided this relation into R1 and R2, two sub-relations. Now you have to check, is this decomposition dependency preserving or not. For that, first step is what? You need to find out functional dependency set of these sub-relations. The question is how to find out functional dependency set of these relations. It's not like that by directly looking at this, you write down, see, A can drive B, so yeah, I have AB, so yeah, this one is in this, A can drive B, B can drive C, B and C I am having in this, so it is B drive C, C drive D, it should be in this one, D drive A. Now, where you will write this D drive A, because D attribute is in this subrelation, A is in this subrelation. So, we cannot write down. So, this is not a proper, you know, procedure to find out functional dependency set of subrelations. No. What is the process? See. Here we have three attributes. So, find out the closure of all the attributes. First of all, single attributes. Then, two attributes means AB, BC, AC. Then ABC, three attributes, right? No need to write down the, find out the closure of ABC means all the attributes, because that would be a trivial functional dependency, right? Now find out A closure. See, how to find out A closure now? By looking at this functional dependency, the functional dependency of the parent relation. These are child relation, this is parent relation, right? So, now A closure. A can drive which attributes? Definitely A, because of trivial functional dependency. Now, see, if you have A, then you can drive B. Yes, I have A, I can drive B. If you have B, you can drive C. B can drive C. Yes, I have B. If you have C, yes, I have C, so you can derive D. You have D, you can drive A, but I have already written A here. Now, see, A to A is trivial, so we are not going to take it. D, we are not going to take D because D is not in this subrelation, right? D is not a part of the subrelation. So now we will not take D. So now first functional dependency is what? A will drive B, C, right? We got one functional dependency. Now what about B closure? Using B, I can drive B, right? Using B, I can drive C. Using C, I can drive D. Using D, I can drive A. B to B is trivial. We don't have D in this case. So, second you got is B can derive C and A. Using C, C closure also C, then D, then A, then B. But C is trivial. D is not a part of this relation. So, we will take only AB. So, C can derive AB. Three functional dependencies we got, right? Now, check for AB. The combination of two attribute. See what AB closure will contain. Definitely AB, right? And using AB, see, using A I can drive B, I have B. Using B I can drive C. Using C I can drive D, right? All the attributes means ABCD, not all the attributes, only ABCD. Now AB is trivial, right? D is not a part of this relation, so we are not going to take D. Now the functional dependency is AB can derive C, but here, see, this functional dependency is what? Duplicate functional dependency. Why so? Because using A only, I can derive C, right? So, definitely using AB, I can derive C. Are you getting something new here in this functional dependency? No. So, this is what duplicate, you can discard it. Or simple short trick is what? If the single attribute A can derive all the attribute of that subrelation, not the parent relation. In this subrelation, I have only A, B and C. So, A can derive, obviously A can drive A and B, C. So, A can drive all the attribute of this subrelation, right? So, no need to check this A with combination of other attributes, means A, B or A, C. No need to check this one, because this would definitely be a duplicate functional dependency. See, let us take one more example. Suppose I am taking this one, BC. So, BC closure would contain BC, then D, then A. BC to BC is trivial. D is not a case, not attribute of this relation. So, functional dependency is BC can derive A. But see, here, only B can derive A, right? by splitting property, you can write B can derive C, B can derive A. So definitely if you combine this B with any other attribute, then you will get A. Right? Means if you will not write down this functional dependency, then also you can derive this A using only B. So this is what duplicate functional dependency. You are not getting something new here. So no need to write down this one. Same here, A and C. This would also, or you can say duplicate functional dependency, no need to check this one, right? Complete ABC, that would be trivial, so no need to write down that also. So now here, the functional dependency set is F1 is containing. I hope you got how to find out functional dependency for subrelation. If you didn't get, then it's okay, we have one more case. See how to find out functional dependency set of this subrelation. First, same, we will find out closure of each attribute, single attribute first of all, right? C closure would contain C. How to find out closure? By looking at the parent functional dependency set. Using C, I can drive D. Yes, using D, I can drive A. Using A, I can drive B. But C to C is trivial. Now AB is not a part of this subrelation, so no need to write down this. Now here the functional dependency is C can derive D, right? What about D closure? D, A, then B, then C. D to D is trivial, AB is not a part of this relation, so D can derive C. What about E closure? Using E, I can drive E, but by looking at this functional dependency, we cannot drive anything else. So E to E is trivial, we are not going to write down this functional dependency. Now, take the two attributes, means CD, then DE, then CE. Using CD, I can drive CD. After that, using C, I can drive D. Using D, I can drive A. Using A, I can drive B. But CD to CD is trivial, AB is not part of this thing, so we get nothing, right? What about DE? Using DE, I can drive DE, and using D, I can drive A. A, I can drive B. Using B, I can drive C, right? But DE is trivial. No need to write down this thing. AB is not a part of this thing. And remaining is DE can derive C, right? But here also, see, only D can derive C. So here, no need to write down this functional dependency because this would be duplicate, right? Only using the single attribute D, I can derive C. So here I am taking two attributes, D and E. So I am not getting something extra. This is, if you will not take this one, then also we can derive C using only D, right? What about CE? I can derive C and E, then D, then A, then B. CE is trivial, AB is not a part of this thing. So CE can derive D. But here alone C can derive D. So no need to write down this functional dependency, this is duplicate. So here, now you can take three attributes, but no need to take three attributes because that would be trivial. See, here, if you will have four attributes, then first of all, you will check closure for single attribute, then two attributes, then three attribute, and then four. But no need to check for four attributes because that would be trivial one. But here I am having only three attributes. So the functional dependency set for this one is suppose F2. Now F1 union F2, and that must be equivalent to this F. It means if it is a case, then that is functional dependency preserving decomposition. So F1 union F2, this would contain, now you have to check this F1 union F2 is equivalent to F or not. Suppose you can write down this as G, or you can take F1 union F2. It's up to you. Now, when you can say these two set are equivalent, suppose I am taking this as G and this is F. If every functional dependency of this G is member of F and every functional dependency of this F is member of this G, then only you can say these are equivalent, right? Now, first of all, we will check that every functional dependency of this F is member of this G, or you can say the union of these two. Now how to check? See, functional dependency is A drive B. Is it member of this union? A drive B. Yes, it is there. Right? A drive B. Here A drive B, A drive C. You can write down two separate functional dependency. B drive C. Is it member of this one? Yes, B drive C. C drive D. Yes, C can derive D. Now next is D drive A. Is it member of this one? See, if you will here check directly, D drive C. But here you cannot say that this is not a member of this functional dependency. The proper way to check is what? See, find out D closure. D closure, if you will find out, and we are checking that this is member of this or not. So using this set, using this functional dependency set, we will find out D closure. D closure, we can write down D using trivial functional dependency. Using D, see, by checking in this functional dependency, using D I can derive C. So I have D, so I can derive C. Now using C, check, using C I can derive A and B. I have C, yes, so I can derive A and B, right? Now see, it is part of, A is part of D closure. It means definitely D drive A would be a member of this functional dependency. This is how we are going to check, okay? If directly you are not able to see that this is present or not, then find out the closure of this one, the determinant, right? And if in the closure of this determinant you find out that the right hand side is there, then definitely that functional dependency would be there. So now here we have A in this D closure, so definitely D drive A would be part of this one. So each functional dependency of this F is member of this union, right? So it means you can say this one G, right? I am taking this as G in short form. G covers F, right? Or you can say G is superset of F. Now we have checked one condition, that every member of this F is part of G. Second is to check the equivalent, this equivalent property. Second is what? You need to check that every member of this one, this G, is also a part of F. Means we have already checked that this G will cover F, but now you have to check this F covers G or not. Means every member of this one, every member, every functional dependency of this is a member of F. But here no need to check. This would definitely be true. So you can pause the video and you can think. And if you find out the answer, you can tell me in the comment box. But here I am going to tell you the answer. See, every member of this one must be a member of this F. Why so? Because we have derived these functional dependencies from this set only using this process, right? We have derived these functional dependency using this functional dependency, using the original functional dependency set. So definitely every member, every functional dependency of this union would be a part of this functional dependency, would be a member of this functional dependency, right? That is for sure, there is no doubt. And if by mistake you got a functional dependency here that is not a member of this original one, means the parent functional dependency set, then definitely the question is, how did you derive that functional dependency using this functional dependency set if it is not a member of this one, the original functional dependency set, the parent functional dependency set, right? So no need to check this F covers G. This would always be true. You need to check, is G cover F or not? Means, is every functional dependency of this F is part of this one, this G, means F union, F1 union F2 or not, right? Now here, yes, it is true, means this is equivalent. So you can say this decomposition is dependency preserving. Yes, this is dependency preserving decomposition. But this dependency preserving property is not a compulsory property for decomposition. That lossless is compulsory, but this is not compulsory. Why so? Because sometimes it is not possible to get dependency preserving decomposition, and that would be a case only in BCNF decomposition. Sometimes the BCNF decomposition will not be dependency preserving, but before third, means up to third normal form, it is always possible to get dependency preserving decomposition. This case is exceptional case, that also we will discuss later with the help of an example, right? So now I hope you got how to find out that a particular decomposition is dependency preserving or not, right? It may be little bit confusing that how to find out this equivalency, G covers F or F covers G and all. If you want me to make a proper separate video using this, means by to explain this equivalency, how to check this equivalent property of these functional dependency set, means two functional dependency set are equivalent or not. So I can make a proper video. You can tell me in the comment box, a separate video with the help of an example. So now at last, one question for you is, you can tell me this relation R as in which normal form, the highest normal form for this relation R, right? We have already discussed this case, how to identify the highest normal form with help of many examples, right? So you can tell me in the comment box. So I hope you got what is the dependency preserving decomposition. In the next video, I'll discuss lossless decomposition with the help of an example. Okay, so now I'll see you in the next video. Till then, bye, take care.